morning, everybody. For those that I didn't have a chance to say hello to, my name is Steve Mazzola. I am Grants Director here at the DC Commission on the Arts. Thanks for joining us on this morning, interrupting your graduate shopping for the audience when we get a lot of you back in plenty of time. It's my great pleasure to introduce our chair, Kay Kendall. Most of you have had the opportunity to meet her maybe at the Mayor's Arts Awards or maybe at the Holiday Hoedown. She's great at a party. But she's even better as an arts, humanities, and arts education advocate. It's been really a terrific period to work with her, learn from her, get guidance from her, and we're just extremely grateful. So she's going to give a brief welcome, and then we'll get started.
Thank you, Stephen. I'm so glad to be here and so glad to see such great turnout. We've been looking forward to today for literally months, and when it snowed last night, I just don't know, but it's beautiful, and here you are. I just wanted to say a few words. The team from the commission is going to go into a lot of detail about what we're presenting today, but I just wanted to say we really tried to listen to the community and hear what your needs are, and my deep hope is that what we're launching today answers those needs. There are a couple of very specific things that we had heard, and one is the need for more money for general operating. I think this will satisfy that. The need to know sooner, because you want to plan your budget, and so we want to satisfy that. And the need to eliminate some risk. The panel process is pretty terrific, but it can be different year to year, and we know that you want something you can count on. We also hope that this DC Heritage Grant will lend a little cachet to your organization. Those are just a few of the things that we hope we're addressing, and you'll hear all the details starting now. Back to Stephen. So glad you're here.
Thank you. Welcome. So we can go to the first slide. So our agenda for today, we'll begin by discussing the challenge, some issues that we've been experiencing. We know you've been experiencing them as well. Then we'll move into our process. Some things that we looked at in terms of national best practices and internal questioning that we have with our commissioners and staff and the community, as well as some peer funders. Then we'll talk about our proposal, our response to that situation. What we think, our chair just gave a quick preview of it. Our desired outcomes, what we see in the future, our long-term goals from this program. And then of course, we'll have time for questions from all of you. So the challenge. It was a busy summer for us. As some of you know, the commission convened 31 panels, using over 250 volunteer panelists, reviewing over 800 applications. Also during that time, we were wrapping up publication of the strategic plan. The strategic plan is available on the commission's website, has lots of chapters on public art events, but certainly we were focused on grants. And really the three top items that, in regard to grants, that were mentioned in the strategic plan was the evaluating the efficiency of program delivery, strengthening the impact of our grant programs, exploring methods for funding general operating support as a means of stabilizing year-to-year grant amounts for grantees. And I see a lot of you shaking your heads, so again, if you've been listening, once we have this information, as soon as we got through the application season, we knew we had to begin work right away. Great. This is a comparison of growth from between FY15 and FY16. I want to draw your attention primarily to our grants made general operating support line. You'll see that in 15, 107 organizations applied for general operating support funding, and in FY16, this past summer, we had over 126 organizations apply for general operating funding. I am now in my fifth year at the commission. When I started, there were 65. So we've had a really rapid period of growth, which of course is terrific information, lots of programs, lots of new activities. Our total applications went from 663 in FY15 to 792 in FY16. That also includes the Artist Fellowship Program, which is our general operating support for individuals, which of course is exciting news as well. We're going to contrast that with a recent report using information from the Cultural Data Project. So you see that it actually does have merits and does good things. And these were some trends in an 11-city peer study, including the Bay Area, including Chicago, and including Boston. And I pulled out information about pertaining to DC. And you see that there were reported declines in government and corporate support. Of course, for us and for all of you, that's sort of a double whammy because we're both the state and the municipality. There were the second largest decline in foundation support in the 11-city study. There was the largest decline in spending by arts and humanities organizations towards making arts and humanities programs and services in the 11-city study. So people were cutting back on the amount of programming that they were doing. And really, one of the most impactful, disturbing, is the largest drop in paid employment amongst arts and humanities organizations in the 11-city study. So when you think about that period of really explosive growth, and yet this reduction in foundation support, and so the time to make change was right away. I'm going to have my colleague Raven Spurlock take a little bit of a deeper dive with some of that information.
So welcome to King's Dominion. This is a view that might be familiar to some of you. This chart shows the course of 12 different organizations over a four-year period from fiscal year 13 to 16, and the number of grants they received each year, the amount of funds they received from the Arts Commission, ups and downs, and how can you plan for that? This is a deeper dive into one of those organizations, fiscal year 13 being at the top and 16 at the bottom. Across, you'll see the number of grant opportunities that the Arts Commission offered that year, which ones this organization applied to, which ones it received, which ones were not offered in any particular year, and on the far left in green, which ones they turned back in because they had hit that 3-5-2 rule. I'd also like to point out in fiscal year 13, we had the Arts Stabilization Grant, which some of you may remember. It was a one-time grant opportunity due to an increase influx of funds we received that year. And this sorbet color Venn diagram is from fiscal year 16 only. 23 organizations applied to Arts Ed, 21 to City Arts Projects, 25 to Grants and Aid. The significant number here is that 21 in the center. These are 21 organizations that apply to all three of these programs, knowing that if they received all three, they would need to turn one of those grants back in. And now I'm passing off to my colleague, Curtis Foy.
Good morning. I will describe here the challenge of what my colleagues have just described. The commission should be growing its grants budget, not the number of ways the budget can be divided. What we're trying to do here is that we're trying to increase your opportunity to get funding and not have you have to do the number of applications. So we're trying to make it easier for you to get the grant dollars. And we also, what we're trying to do here, we want to grow the applicants. The artists and the arts and humanities organizations, these are the people that we are interested in helping, and this is the process of what we're trying to do. We do not want to grow the applications. We want to grow you all. We want to have you do more arts programming and less work with the applications. Here it says that varied funding levels and many programs equal instability. What we don't want is instability with your organization. We want you to have stability in your planning, stability in your budget. This will allow you to plan ahead. So this is the challenge of what we've heard from you. This is the challenge of what we're trying to eradicate. We want to make it easier for you because we've heard your voice. And this is what this is saying here. We want you to be more stable in what you're doing as an organization and an artist. And now I go to this process here of knowing the process, and my colleague David Markey will do that for us.
Hello. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the arts education person at the commission. So we do did not just pull this idea out of the air. About 15, 18 months ago, we engaged a company to work on our strategic plan. And that company met with many stakeholders, several hundred individuals in small focus groups. And there were some recurring themes that bubbled to the surface, one of which was the idea of the Commission taking on a leadership role beyond grant making. Oftentimes, grant making has a traditional transactional role that you submit your application, we quote unquote grade you. You're successful, here's a check, good luck with your program, see you next year. And so what came out of those, the work of the strategic planners was, what else, what other role can the commission fulfill? We in the Arts Education Department, when I arrived there, I started to look at applications and reports to see where there were some deficits or where we could help build that up, what it was we could do. So we started looking at ways of helping with professional development. That's often a budget line item that is cut pretty quickly when the budgets get tight mid-year. So this past year, for example, we engaged applicants and grantees in assessment and evaluation workshops to really understand the scope of what that means. That it's more than just doing surveys. We also offered several workshops on access and inclusion. So unwrapping that idea of, well, what's the scope of access? Is it having elevators and wheelchair ramps, or are we talking financial access, cultural development, or particularly where children and youth are concerned. So it's something that we're moving forward and will continue to offer such opportunities, which is, I don't want to give anything away, which Stephen will talk a little bit more about, but this idea should really help make stronger connections between the Commission.
Just before we move forward, we want to say hello to everybody who is following us via Twitter and tweeting hashtag DCHGP. It's a great way to get us questions, even though they've chickened out by not actually coming in person. That's fine. So in her charge to our terrific new executive director, Arthur Espinosa Jr., Mayor Muriel Bowser gave three tasks to him and indeed his leadership for the agency. The first was grow our creative economy, broaden access to the arts, and spur job growth. But in some of my research, I came across this in reading about Pennsylvania, and I sort of found my way into this job, but I think what goals I personally have for our work and the work of my colleagues is this idea behind healthy communities. One side of a healthy community is its simultaneous ability to preserve and invent its culture. That is to conserve its history and heritage while developing new expressions for current times. And I thank all of you for doing that. I think you're all participating in that. We just want to better support you in your efforts to do that. So it's now And in order for you to do that, what we have gleaned from all of you is that you need knowledge of your general operating support earlier to accommodate your budgeting and planning. You need knowledge of your general operating support earlier to work with other funders, so you have a sense of what next year will be. And knowledge of your general operating support earlier to encourage growth, either through wider impact or better delivery on mission, this idea of risk capital, that you are able to take chances because you have a sense of what your future is going to be in addition to existing programming. So here's our proposal for Grant 17. You're getting a first preview, really snappy new logo, thanks for graphic designer Teresa. And here to introduce our proposal is our executive director, Arthur Espinosa Jr.
Hello and good morning and to all of you in Periscope land or wherever you are on Twitter. Sorry you're not here, because after this presentation, we're going to clear the chairs and we're going to have a dance class. So, yeah, that's just how we do it. And I want to thank Carla for helping us find this beautiful space. Dance Place, Dance Will sort of runs this this space. How many of y'all have been here before? Great, I see a lot of no hands. That means that we need to introduce new things to you. So in terms of our introduction about what we're going to show you here, we're also showing you this beautiful space, which I think is available for the Pride Slip. I remember. All right, so we're going to talk about this grant funding cycle for the next year. One of the things that we did is we said, let's really take into account all that we've been talking about, what's really important for us, what do we as producers, or y'all as producers, I used to be one of you so I can say that sort of, what do you need? Well, we understand all these things that we've been talking about. We need to know earlier what our funding is going to look like. We need to ensure as much as we can that we're going to be able to get that. So what we did is we said in the grant funding programs, we're going to bifurcate them. We're going to take and we're going to make this one that is a little bit more stable, if you will. Now, that's not to be read as a stability grant because I can't be in a position of giving you multi-year grants, which would really give you stability, I understand, or at least some sense of stability. So what we can do is we get the second best, which is to say we're going to have the first grant program roll out earlier in the year. So if we know about that earlier winter-spring cycle, that helps many of us in our budgeting. We're usually planning, so if you don't find out until June what your grant is really going to be, you're still at a little bit at risk. So eliminating some of that risk means let's know earlier. So the DC Heritage Grant Program is about providing the general support, which we know is critical. We're not into saying, all right, it's got to be about a specific program with this grant program. It has to be a specific project. We're saying, you decide, you're leaders, you're smart, you know what it takes, and we're going to roll that up earlier. So this is for arts and humanities and arts education organizations that are founded on or prior to 1/1/09. So that's an important date to remember. You need to have at least 7 years of consistent service that you're providing in the DC area and consistent funding from the commission. So that's already kind of putting you in this, as we mentioned earlier, a sort of stamp of approval category by being in the DC Heritage Program. We'll still continue with the next cycle, which will then roll out spring-summer. So this is later. This is one that you want to reserve for project grants, if you're looking at specifically that. Also in these areas, particularly arts education, East of the River, festivals, projects, those sort of one-off kind of events that you produce. This is really where we're going to start to steer those organizations that are a little more nascent, those that are up and coming, or projects that are unique. So those are the two cycles that we're going to do. Now, that's just the broad view of all this. I know you have questions. Hold on. We'll get to them. We're going to go to the fine print.
Thank you, Arthur. And the fine print. So how HGP will work? Very similar. Eligible arts and humanities and arts education organizations will submit one application by the portal. The applications will be reviewed and ranked by a peer review panel, as in previous years. Ranking and reporting information will be presented by the Grants Committee to the Executive Director. So this way, our relationship as program managers with all of you will have impact in the outcome of the funding decisions. We really enjoy our time with you and our site visits. That work had never really had a role, and it was very important for us for that to now be participating in the outcome. So it's the entirety of it. The recommendations are presented to the commissioners. We have three commissioners. In addition to our chair, it's a great privilege to introduce Edmund Fleet, Tony Ford, and Commissioner Stacey Banks are here with us today. And then you'll receive an intention to fund. Of course, the budget will not have been determined at this time. We'll be using, have been looking at our FY16 numbers for thinking about what the future would be and how this would work. But again, like this year, there's a lot of paperwork to fill out. That's why it's an intention to fund. Moving forward. So then, of course, for all of you, the question, so how much? Very similar to how GIA has worked in the past. These cohorts are determined by your cash expenses in FY15. These are very conservative numbers. We're being very conservative right now because we think a lot of people are going to be eligible and a lot of people are going to apply. The percentages, as you can see, the smaller your cash expenses are, the larger the percentage you'll get. And it will be something that we hope will be continuing to grow and invest in the future. And I think we can move forward. Oh, and just in addition, we're now capping our support for organizations at 35% through all funding. The national average for government support is 20%. This is something that not a lot of people encounter, but as part of our transparency, it's just something we want you all to be aware of. Great, and the outcomes. We hope through this process that we've created a funding designation that's valuable for the community to employ. Our artist fellowship recipients really take great pride in their fellowship and in participation. And we know because of that instability in funding levels, you may get a better arts ed one year, a better city art project. We really hope that this HGP symbolizes our commitment to you and the exemplary work that you've been doing, that it really is one of our major programs. A program that supports long-term sustainability as it incentivizes growth through risk and innovation. Rapid turnaround on notification with more time to do deeper dives with organizations that need it. A method for DCCAH knowledge integration to be incorporated into the process. And increased credibility for DCCAH-supported organizations while increasing credibility for the DCCAH for the intentionality of its program design. So that we're not really thinking just year to year, we're thinking many years into the future. That's what we hope to realize with all of this. And we believe it says to our community is that we support arts and humanities and arts education organizations with an exemplary history of programming in DC, assess arts education and other field-building enterprises who focus on inclusion, diversity, equity, and access, financial resiliency through varied, sustained, and scalable streams of income with clear indicators of drivers to the creative economy. You are our mission-critical core constituency, and we really want to make sure that for doing great work, for taking risks, for growth, that you have our confidence in support from the Commission. So how do we pay for it? This is an example of how funding occurred for FY16. As you can see, general operating grants and aid was about half of our operating budget. When we move into FY17, next slide, thank you, you'll see that we have increased our general operating support. What we've reduced has been our arts education and our city art project lines. And we did that because we know a lot of you do that through your general operating and your programming. We have not touched our East of the River program funding level at all. And we also haven't touched our artist fellowship program in any way. Those things are secure and clear. And now not so far, Prince. And I'm going to have Raymond take over.
Okay, so here we have what will be the now kind of choose your own adventure approach to applications. On the left, for nascent arts, humanities, and arts education organizations, those founded after 1109, as well as the community organizations founded at any time. So those are our charter schools, our churches, health organizations, any organization that wants to do an arts project, 501c3 in the district. They'll have their choice of two of one of our project grants, arts education, festivals, and projects, or East of the River, or if they are eligible, one of facilities or upstart. And for the organizations who are eligible for heritage, they will be able to apply for that and as eligible cultural facilities or upstart. Here is our tentative schedule for this spring. So the DC Heritage Grant applications will come available next week on the 29th at the end of the week. You can see the schedule for that. Don't forget interim reports will be due in March. And then our project grants will be on a really similar timeline to last year, which is that April, May for all of the workshops and deadlines. Frequently asked questions, and I'm turning it back over to someone.
Frequently asked questions, so we know you have questions, we had a lot of questions, the community had a lot of questions, and so here were some that we've encountered, and then we'll open the floor to all of yours. So our first one is, so why are you doing this, and why now? I think David died.
As I mentioned earlier, you know, a lot of this thinking came out of the strategic plan, the work that we did on the strategic plan. We think it's the right thing to do. As you all know, general operations dollars are the most difficult to secure. They're not sexy, but yet they're the most valuable. They allow you to keep your doors open and your staff paid and happy, and so on. And in part, it will allow us, as everyone else has said, to spend more time with you, getting to know your programs, really understanding the challenges you face, and hopefully being able to help you in some way to overcome those challenges. Oh, yes. So, next question. Isn't this program just like the Commission's Earth Stabilization Grant from 2013?
Reagan? It is and it isn't. So, the Earth Stabilization Grant, as a one-time grant, didn't really serve to stabilize, but it did sort on organizational history, which is something that we are using in the DC Heritage Grant Program. The DC Heritage Grant Program will function more like a philosophy moving forward. That it's not a one-time thing, and it's something we'll continue to use. And the next question. What about the district's commitment to arts education and to organizations east of the river?
Glad you asked that question, Maria. Well, we have over 50% of the organizations eligible for the DC Heritage Grant. They are arts education programs, and organizations that are located east of the river. Organizations like Life Pieces, the Masterpieces, Project Create, the ARC, and many others will be eligible for this grant. Why don't you push your organizations by eliminating their access to general operating dollars? We need them too.
Oh, we know you need them, and you have access to them. You have 35% of them. Every project has 35%, which is allocated for overhead, and 65%, which is allocated for the program. What we're doing is we're focusing unrestricted general operating support on historic organizations that have demonstrated sustainability. We looked at the period of 1109 as those that came from the Great Recession and demonstrated that they're still here. We're using projects as a way to grow nascent organizations, as a way for us to learn about them. We're really not eliminating anything. We're really just trying to focus appropriately and manage taxpayer dollars in a more appropriate fashion. Our next question. Aren't you shaping outcomes by limiting eligibility?
Kind of, sort of, but in a good way. And what we found, again, is that there are a lot of amazing development folk here from mid to large size organizations who write rock star grants that really reflect the program on the ground. What we found is that there are some organizations, both smaller to mid size organizations, where we have folks who are wearing multiple hats. And sometimes their application doesn't necessarily reflect the program on the ground. In the past, the mandate we give to panelists is that they focus their scoring solely on what is on paper, as it were, in front of them, and that they're not allowed to bring any outside or peripheral knowledge to their decision making. And the reason that was because it's really fair, that's sort of it, to be fair, that there's maybe an organization that's a household name that everybody knows, and they think, oh, they didn't submit a great application, but we know they do really great work. But then, similarly, there may be an organization that is not a household name that does equally excellent work, but their application just didn't reflect that. So, as Stephen mentioned earlier, we now are hoping to have an opportunity to, as grant managers, to really participate in that. So we are the ones that go on site visits. We're the ones that dialogue with you guys. So hopefully it's, we're approaching it that we want everybody to get on the funding ladder and to deliver the best programming that is possible to the residents, visitors, workers of the District of Columbia. Next question. So, as far as DCHGP goes, does that mean good, right?
No, not at all. It's participation in the Heritage Grant Program is not a mission to become complacent about what you do.
You will be demonstrating your programs in arts education, East of the River, and your projects, and that will be establishing markers that we'll be using to assess your growth and your sustainability. So it's there will also be certain operational triggers, such as a change in leadership without letting the patient know, acquisition of a new venue, a dramatic shift in programming from how we began our relationship to where it is now, which at this point may say, we're not going to strip away your funding, but maybe during this period, project grants would be a better fit. So it's not just something that once you're in, you're good. It's just once you're in, we'll talk to you later in the year, really. Okay, and I feel like every time I get the commission's grant programs, you change it. What's up with that?
Welcome to the living, breathing world of the agency that is the DC Commission on the Arts and Humanities. We, like you, we have to live in modern times and we have to take into account all the changing landscape that's around us. So yes, we're changing, and we're changing also because we listen to you, because as we mentioned during our strategic planning process, we took a lot of input and we put it into play. So we said, what is it that people need? All these things that we've been talking about, it'd be nice to know earlier, it'd be nice to eliminate some risk, it'd be really great if we had something that recognized the good work that we're doing in the community. And so we tried to put something out there that did that. I also had a second goal, which was, I don't want all that paperwork time eating up the time that we have to serve you better. And one of the ways that we can do that is to be able to have the conversation that we know is so important that we have every day with our audiences and the people that we serve. So this opportunity for us as an agency allows us to get to know you all better. Most of you have maybe seen Stephen once or twice or talked to him on the phone or sent him a couple of emails. But we really want to have that opportunity to speak together and to learn from one another so that we can better serve. It only happens in that way. It's one of the reasons why we rolled this out in this very format. It wasn't about a big show. It was about people coming together and talking in a nice, intimate, beautiful space and having this day to figure out how we can move forward. Is it going to be perfect? Probably not. Is it going to be something we're going to pay attention to? Absolutely. So it means that along the way, we're also getting information and growing and gaining new knowledge to be able to continue to hone this and make it as best as we can. In the meantime, understanding what you're doing and how you're doing that is of vital importance to us. So the conversation part of it will be really important. The follow-up reporting will also be really important. But we won't necessarily bog you down with lots of applications, and that's one of the other things that we thought was really important that we take into consideration with this. So, snap. We have a few people to thank.
Great, thank you. So we want to acknowledge all the people that gave us feedback along with what really shaped us, beginning with our chair, Kay Kimmel, and members of the Grants Committee, which include Commissioner Stacey Banks, who's here, Commissioner Susan Clampett, Barbara Jones, and Gretchen Morton, our executive director. As you can see, we're in very good hands with Arthur. And our interim director, Derek Younger. The 137 panelists from the FY16 general operating support season. And then I proceeded to launch in a bunch of community interviews, getting your responses, seeing what works, what doesn't work, hearing your thoughts on the direction that we're going in. It's been terrific. I've also been able to connect with some peer funders like the Kresge Foundation, the Irvine Foundation in California, and some folks at the National Network for the Arts, really just to take a look at what other state arts agencies are doing, how they're modeling, understanding that DC is different, but trying to get best practices from them as well. So really thanks to everyone. It's been a 4-month journey coming to this day, so it's terrific to be here. So next slide. And really, yeah, we'll take questions from all of you. I think we've done.